Do you know what the best CSS utility-first library is? Hint, it's not Tailwind CSS. Stick to the end of this video and find out not only that, but also if you can offer syntax highlighting without any JavaScript, if CSS Grid really is slower than Flexbox, and if it matters, and more. This episode is sponsored by Scrimba, more on that in a bit. First up, we have State of CSS 2024 survey. This is probably the most important, the most relevant survey about CSS in the industry. It was just opened, so make sure you fill it out. It will not only help you understand where your CSS skill level currently is, but even more importantly, it will help browser vendors decide where their development priorities should be when it comes to CSS, new features, and APIs. Next up, we have an article by Heikki Lotvonen. In this article, Heikki explains that one of the roadblocks for creating a hand-coded website, programming website, or blog is syntax highlighting. Hand-coded in this example meaning that you don't rely on third-party scripts or libraries. Standard JavaScript-based syntax highlighters add to the overall bloat and complexity of a web page, so Heikki explored if it's possible to avoid that altogether by adding syntax highlighting directly into the font. Long story short, yes, it is possible by utilizing OpenType features. Heikki will tell you more. This week's sponsor is Scrimba, a collection of fantastic courses to level up your coding skills. Unlike other courses, Scrimba offers interactive lessons, meaning that you'll code directly in the course lessons, which is a really fantastic experience, and I strongly suggest you try it out. That's how good it is. They offer free and premium courses, and as a CSS Weekly reader, you will get 20% discount if you click the link in the description. Your discount will automatically be applied when you click the link, and it is valid only in the next 2 weeks, so make sure you click it now. Thanks so much to Scrimba for sponsoring. Have you ever wondered about rendering performance difference between CSS Grid and Flexbox? Does it matter? Ben Frain explored exactly that and created a test case with more than 200 elements to see if there is any meaningful difference. And if you look at the results, the difference is pretty much negligible. In this test, results were about 2 milliseconds difference between Grid and Flexbox for Chrome and about 4 on average for Safari. Basically, this means that you pretty much don't have to think about rendering performance when you're creating layouts. Next up, we have Ilya Grigorik and Jeremy Wagner explain the importance of choosing the right image format. The first thing that you need to ask yourself is, do I even need an image in the first place? Perhaps you can achieve the same result by using pure CSS. Maybe you create a pure CSS illustration that is simple enough so you don't waste too much time on it. Or you can achieve the same result by utilizing web fonts, or even creating a simple CSS animation. Of course, there is no alternative to an actual image or video for that matter, and if you do want to include an image on your web page, which is very resource intensive, first and foremost in the terms of size, of course, then you need to be able to select the appropriate image format. And in this article, you will get clear advice on when to choose which image format, what are the implications of high resolution screens, what are the features of different image formats. For example, did you know that you can animate PNGs using a PNG format, and more. And now we finally gotten to the best utility first CSS library that has ever been created. It's called Batman-Comic.CSS by Alvaro Montoro. Obviously, this isn't a library that will help you in your day-to-day work, but it is a ton of fun to play around with this one. It allows you to create pure CSS comics that feature Batman and Robin. And if you never worked with utility first library, this is a good start where you might get an idea of how those types of libraries work, what are their advantages or maybe even disadvantages, and how you actually like using them. I had a ton of fun trying out this one, and I created my first comic. It's available on CodePen, and the link is going to be in the description as well. And this is the comic that I came up with, where Batman is trying to save the world by utilizing box sizing and interpolate size CSS properties. I'm sure you're familiar with box sizing, but if you want to learn more about interpolate size property, you can learn all about it in a video that's going to be linked down there in the description. I apologize if I misled you in my introduction. It was not my intention. I really did enjoy playing around with this library, and I really do think it's a ton of fun to actually create your own comics using Batman-Comic.CSS. Lastly, we have an interactive gradient and glassmorphism with noise demo created by Tomaski. I really love this demo. It looks very simple and it's not very complicated in terms of code, but it is stunning and beautiful and something that you can actually use in your own projects if you want your landing pages to really stand out. As you move your mouse around here, the effect is actually following you, and this glassmorphism is really beautifully and really nicely done. Furthermore, it reminds me of one of my earliest videos here on YouTube that I've created on how to create a glassmorphism effect. If you want to learn more about glassmorphism, check it out. If you want to get inspiration on creating fascinating effects like this one, then definitely check this demo by Tomaski. It's really stunning. And now I have a very important question for you. Will you try out Batman Comics CSS library? And have you already filled out State of CSS 2024? Please let me know in the comments. A simple no-no or no-yes will do. Thank you so much for your attention. My name is Zoran Jambor. I will see and hear you in a different Batman comic. Or rather, in the next video.